With the introduction of the fingerprint sensor, Samsung has given our phones a more personal way to recognize its user. Hi again everyone, it's Michael from Samsung Developers, here to show you the S Pass Memo. Let's begin with an overview. In a previous episode, we took a look at how the fingerprint sensor is used with the Pass SDK. This episode will focus more on applying the Pass SDK in an actual app you can use called S Pass Memo. It's simply an app that can keep your memos in a database and secures access to the app using the Pass SDK. The database is just a simple one kept in the phone. While we won't be able to use all the features of the Pass SDK, we can use enough based on what our app needs. Before we get to development, here's what we need to get started. For development, we're going to use Eclipse with the Android Developer Tools. You can download the Pass SDK from developer.samsung.com and make sure to include it in your Libs folder. Optionally, you can download the action bar icon pack from developer.android.com so you can use it in your app if you don't have your own icons. For the phone, the Pass SDK needs at least Android 4.2 Jelly Bean or higher. Importantly, the phone should have a fingerprint sensor to work. In our demonstration later, I'll be using the Galaxy S5. Now that we've sorted out the requirements, let's get started with the development. We've already prepared a project for S Pass Memo. Let's have a closer look at it, shall we? Our project's minimum SDK has been set to API level 19, KitKat 4.4.2, since our test device, the Galaxy S5, started at that version. Starting with the needed assets, we imported the libraries that came with the Pass SDK from Samsung Developers. Also, we included some icons from the Action Bar icon pack. For the Android manifest, make sure to include the needed Write Use App Feature Survey permission to be used later. With the main activity, we set the padding to 10 dp so the items won't reach the page edge. We then made a list view called List View Memo, whose width and height fill the entire parent, which is the page. Moving on, let's head over to the main activities menu. Here we added a menu item called Action Add Memo. We've set it to use one of the icons we imported earlier, which was a plus sign. The Show as Action If Room property means that the icon will be shown on the action bar if there's enough room. We prepared an onClick method called showEditMemo, which we'll add code to shortly. Lastly, we placed the menu's title in strings.xml to keep the texts organized. For the addMemo with the showEditMemo method, we'll simply call startActivity with the intent to open editActivity. Since we have a list in our main activity, let's go prepare what the list item should look like. The first of our list item views is the text view called txtListItemTitle. The width and height will be wrapped to the content placed while the alignment has been placed at the start and top of the parent view. We gave it the text title as a temporary holder. Finally, we gave it the large text appearance to emphasize what its body contains later. Similarly for the text body of our memo, we created the text view aligned at the start of the parent view and placed below our list item title. We place the text message content as a placeholder to the content, but set it to have a single line and to ellipsize the end. Afterwards, we set the text appearance to be small just as a preview of the body. Next, we created the edit activity, which contains two edit text fields. We also set the padding to be 10 dp to act as a minor border. The first edit text is called txtEditTitle, and we set its width to fill the entire line. We set its text size to be 10ms. Since this is a title, we set the input type to capitalize the start of sentences with our input type tag. To keep the user informed of the field, we set the hint to title. The request focus tag was placed to give attention to the title edit text once the page is loaded. Our next element is the txtEditBody, whose layout follows that of the title. The gravity property has been set to start so the text will always begin at the upper left part of the edit text. We placed a message content hint to let the user know that the part is for the body. Lastly, we set the input type to capitalize sentences and be multiline. With our edit activity also comes the menu layout called edit.xml. We gave it an ID named ActionSaveMemo and an icon from the drawables we imported earlier. Like the add button from earlier, we set it to show as action if room and declared the onClick function to be saveMemo. Lastly, we set the title in the strings.xml. Now that all of our designing is done, let's get to the code behind our app. Starting with the main activity class, let's head over to the onOptionItemSelected method to make sure that the item ID the menu item is referring to exists. Since it was originally for settings, we should change it to Action Add Memo following the menu item we made earlier. The same applies to our Edit Activity class. We should check the item ID of the menu item in case it is still looking at the default and change it to Action Save Memo following our changes earlier. Now let's get to our Memo class, which will define what our memo will have. We started with a memo ID of type long, memo title of type string, and memo body of type string. Here we have two constructors for memo, one that sets a value to all fields, and one that sets only the title and body. To retrieve the data from the memo object, we set getters to all variables. With our memo object ready, we can use it in our database adapter called DB Adapter, which we will show you next. We started with the static and final variables which we will need throughout our database adapter. The tag is meant for logs and debugging purposes. DB name, DB version, and DB table memo are meant for the database name, version, and name of the table we will be using. Key memo ID, key memo title, and key memo body are meant for the columns in the memo table to be used by our app. Next up is DB create table memo, which is the SQL command to create the memo table. Below it, we have a context object which takes the context from the app when the DB adapter is instantiated later. Then we have a database helper object called DB helper, whose class we will define in a moment. Lastly, we declared a SQLite object named DB, whose assignment we'll set later. Now let's move to the constructor of DB adapter. We set the context parameter to be passed from the app to the adapter when it is instantiated. Also, our database helper object is instantiated with the same context. In the same file, we declare our database helper class, which extends the SQLite open helper. In the constructor of the database helper, we set the context as parameter, which we will use when we call the super method, which accepts the context, database name, and database version as parameters. Extending SQLite open helper will require you to implement the onCreate and onUpdate methods. This is where our dbCreateTableMemo string will be used. The onCreate method will be called when the database is created for the first time, so it will execute the SQL command to create the table. The onUpdate method will be called when the database is to be upgraded. Our implementation will drop the memo table and create it again. Going back to our dbAdapter class, we're ready to create the methods we need to help us open, close, insert, update, delete, and get memos from our database. In our open method, we call the database helper's getWritableDatabase and assign it to our SQLite database object called DB, then return the same object using this. In the close method, we just call the database helper's close method to close the database connection. Now let's head over to the functions which will help us add, update, delete, and get memos. First is our insertMemo method, which accepts a memo object and returns a long value. We first create a content values object, which we will put the title and body from the memo object that was passed. Lastly, we will insert the content values object in the memo table using the SQLite database object called DB and return the long value. Next is the deleteMemo method, which accepts the memo ID as reference to the entry it will delete in the database. It simply calls DB's delete method and returns true if it deletes at least one entry. Now let's check updateMemo, which accepts a memo object. Its implementation is also the same as insertMemo by creating a content values object and putting key value pairs. Once complete, it calls DB's update method, specifying the table, values changed, and where clause, which is what the memo ID value is for. It returns true if it updates at least one row. Then we'll need functions to get all memos and one memo. So we have getMemos, which returns an array of memos, and getMemo, which returns a memo object. For getMemos, we first create an array list of type memo called memos. We then declare a cursor object called C, which is assigned the query of the entire memo table. A while loop checks if the cursor has reached the end of the last row. While it has not reached the end, a memo object is created and populated, then added to our memo array list. Once the cursor is done, it is closed and the array list is converted to an array of memos and returned. The getMemo function is a smaller version of getMemos, which specifies the memo ID in the query passed to the cursor. A new memo object is instantiated and populated with the cursor's values and then returned. With our dbAdapter class ready, let's now prepare our array adapter for the list we made earlier. We create a class called ArrayAdapterMemo, which extends the Array Adapter class. In it, we declare a context object, a layout resource ID of type int, and a memo array. In the constructor, we call the Array Adapter super method and pass the context, resource, and memo array parameters to the same three variables inside Array Adapter memo. Next, we override the getView method from the Array Adapter and check if the view parameter is null. If it's null, the layout inflator will be called to instantiate the view objects. Once the view objects have been instantiated, the text in the text views inside the list item we made earlier will be set to the values inside the memo objects accordingly. The TXT title set tag method is passed the memo ID because it will be used later on when opening a memo or when it is about to be deleted. Once all the texts have been set, the convert view object is returned. With our database adapter and array adapter ready, we can now link our user interface with our data. Back at our main activity class, we declare an object named DB of type DBAdapter and instantiate it with the context this. Now let's make a method called refreshMemo to refresh the list of memos we have. All we have to do is use the database adapter object we made earlier and call the open method. Then we declare a memo array and call the getMemos method, passing the return value to the memo array. Afterwards, we close the database adapter. With our array of memos ready, we can now bind the list view we made earlier to our array. To do this, we need to acquire our list view from the layout. Then we instantiate our array adapter memo from earlier, passing the context, list view, resource, and memo array. Once instantiated, we set the list view's adapter to our array adapter. To make our app more interactive, let's put item clicks and long click listeners. We set the onItemClickListener to open a new activity through an intent, passing along the tag which we set in the title using the array adapter. The pass value, which is the memo ID, will be handled by the edit activity as you'll see later. For the onItemLongClickListener, we need to get the context, title, and memo ID from the views. We then create an alert dialog using a builder and prompt the user if they are sure to delete the memo. If they click the positive button labeled as OK, the delete memo method will be called, which will simply open our database adapter, delete the memo with a specific ID, and close the database adapter. The list is then refreshed and the user is notified by toast message that the memo has been deleted. Otherwise, the negative button will simply cancel the dialog. We set the refresh memo to be called each time the onResume state is reached. Now let's add some code in the edit activity class. Inside that class, we declare a database adapter object like in the main activity, but this time, we also add the memo ID of type long. This will help us check if the edit activity was started as new or to open an existing memo. In edit activity's onCreate method, we check if the intent passed to the activity has a memo ID or is null. If it has a memo ID, then the loadMemoData method is called. The loadMemoData method simply gets a memo from the database given the memo ID passed in the intent, and sets the edit text value accordingly. Now for the saveMemo method declared in the saveAction button. A check is first done if there is a memo ID. If there is one, the updateMemoData is called. Otherwise, the saveMemoData is. The updateMemoData method first acquires the title and body from the views, then creates a memo object out of it. The database is then opened and updated with the memo object, then closed. The saveMemoData method follows the same process, only this time, a new memo row is inserted to the table of the database. This finishes the memo part of sMemo. Now let's add the Pass SDK functions. For the Pass SDK, we first create a new function named AuthenticateUser, which is called each time the onCreate state is reached. To start, we instantiate a new object of S Pass called MSPass and an S Pass fingerprint object called MSPassFingerprint. We also declare a Boolean variable called isFeatureEnabled to check for the phone's availability with the fingerprint sensor later. With our S Pass object, we need to call the initialize method, passing the context this inside the try-catch block. If the Pass SDK can't be initialized, a toast message will be shown and the activity will be finished. Once initialized successfully, we now have to check for fingerprint support by calling the isFeatureEnabled of MSPass, passing the device fingerprint as a value. The resulting Boolean value will be passed to the isFeatureEnabled Boolean variable. If the value is false, A toast message will notify the user and the activity will be finished. When the fingerprint service is found to be supported, the app will then check for existing fingerprints registered. If none are available, MS Pass Fingerprints Register Finger method will be called, which will take the user to the phone's fingerprint registration activity. Once a fingerprint is found to be registered in the phone, it can prompt the user to place their fingerprint on the sensor to start identification. In our example, we only needed to add code to the onFinished method to check if the authentication status was a success. Anything other than success is considered as a failure in authentication and will tell the user of the problem before finishing the activity. So that wraps up the coding part. Now let's play with the app we just made. The phone we're using currently has no fingerprints enrolled, so when we run the app for the first time, it takes us to the fingerprint registration screen and tells us to register fingerprints first. Now that we've registered our fingerprints, let's start our app again. As you can see, it now asks for our fingerprint. We'll just swipe our registered finger and the app unlocks for us, ready to take notes. You'll notice that the Add button is ready in the action bar. If we tap it, we're taken to the editor activity to type in our note. I'll go put sample note as the title, and the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog as the body. Then let's save. Going back to our main activity, we see our new note added. If we tap it, we're taken back to our edit screen to make changes and save it. Let's try to close our app. If we reopen it again, it asks for our fingerprint once more. Anyone trying to open our app has to provide our fingerprint before accessing. Since our app just uses a simple database, remember not to keep any confidential information in it since it's not encrypted. So there's our S Pass Memo, a simple note-taking app whose access is protected by fingerprint. Now let's have a wrap on today's episode. In summary, the S Pass Memo is a simple note-taking app that uses the Pass SDK for authentication by fingerprint. The device to be used must have at least Android 4.2 Jelly Bean and a fingerprint scanner to work well. It uses Android's built-in SQLite for the database access. We have three layout files, two for the activities and one for the list item template. We added the Write Use App Feature Survey in the manifest file to use the fingerprint scanner. So that ends our episode today on the S Pass Memo, kept safe by the Pass SDK of Samsung phones. We hope you learned a lot today. For more details and technical resources, please visit us at developer.samsung.com. If you like our video, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to Samsung Developers. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you on the next episode.